Good morning. Welcome. Hey, if you click on the subscribe button and also the notification button, that'll keep you up to date every time we go live and every time we stream. It's just been crazy trying to navigate this pandemic for the church. I've been talking to pastors and they've been saying the same thing. So everybody, there's no real good fine answer, especially for us that we rent space and it's not a space that we lease every day of the week. So that's been a challenge for us. We have our office, but it's just not big enough. So I'd like to ask everybody to really pray for direction for that in space. But here's the good news. The good news is the majority of people are staying connected in small groups. So thumbs up there. Today we have a special guest, Brian Sumner from the West Coast in Huntington Beach. He's going to walk through the third beatitude with us. So if you've been watching, you're going to love this one. So stay tuned. We're going to start into some worship to start off this morning. So would you join us? Let me pray. Father, we just thank you for this morning. Lord, I thank you for each person here that's watching this. I pray that this message and this worship, the message would be a blessing to them, but this worship would be pleasing to you. And Father, we just thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Desperate for you. I surrender. Mercy and grace unfold, hunger and thirst, hunger and thirst. Thumb stretched wide, I know you hear my cry, speak to me. Speak to me now. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know. surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more.
Thank you, Father. And as we surrender to you, as we get to know more about you, we proclaim that you are worthy, worthy of all the praise, worthy of every breath, that you are the name above all names, and we will build our lives upon your rock. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we're near for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We're near for you. We're near you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever be. We're near for you. We're near for you. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are in me. With your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
shaken, and I will build my life upon your law. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder, and show me who you are, and fill me with your heart, and lead me in your love to those around me.
My life upon your love, it is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Well, good morning. Welcome back. Thanks for tuning in. I've got a friend here. Some of you may know him, Brian Sumner. He's a man of God, a husband, a father, evangelist, and we've known him for a number of years now, and he's been out here at BVC. He's joined us in person, but also on Zoom. So I just wanted to introduce Brian. And we're going to talk about Beatitudes this morning. We've started this series a couple weeks ago. First week being God blesses those poor in spirit and those that recognize their need for him. Last week, Nancy did a great job sharing about blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. This week, we're going to talk about humility. So Brian's pretty humble. yeah, no, if you know Brian, he really is Mr. Jiu-Jitsu and where he's been in life and everything like that, but how the Lord is using him. So I'm really looking forward to this message this morning, just really engaging in some thoughts about humility. And let me read the scripture, actually, of what we're actually going to focus on, which is Matthew 5:5. I'm going to read out of two translations. The first one is NIV, which it says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And the second being out of the NLT, New Living Translation, it says, God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the whole earth. And if you've been walking with the Lord for any length of time, maybe this has been a challenge. I don't know. For me, absolutely. Brian, how about you? You know,
if it's been a challenge walking with the Lord or just life or all of it. Yeah.
Just understanding humility and what does it look like and how do we do it? And, you know, coming to Jesus and sometimes we get confused between, you know, meekness and weakness. And, you know, Jesus didn't like lay over, you know, lay down on the ground and play dead.
Yeah.
You know, and try to wrestle that out in our life, you know?
Well, I mean, you come to faith and it's so bold and alive and you can't believe, you hear, you understand the gospel. Wait a minute. God sent his son to die for me. So there's this life transforming moment. And then to answer your question, you begin to realize what's really in you. Now, as a Christian with the Holy Spirit, as you read those verses, you say, well, wait a minute. I still act like this sometimes. I still think like this sometimes. I still respond like that sometimes. And you could say, well, isn't that a bad thing? Well, yes, but it's a good thing because it should keep us humble. So the longer we walk with the Lord, it should actually humble us. I've heard a lot of pastors say the longer they walk with Jesus, the more wretched they see that they are And it was the Apostle Paul in Romans who said, wretched man that I am. Mm-hmm. Many say, no, he used to be wretched. No, what he's saying is my flesh is still wretched. So I know you're joking about me, you know, saying Brian's the most humble guy, which you never want someone to say about you, but it's a compliment. Yeah. But I'm reminded, I heard a friend preaching this the other week, but even you read what Moses wrote. And I mean that because Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, but it says about Moses in Numbers 12:3, Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth.
Right.
And Moses wrote that. So, I mean, God wanted it in there, but Moses, what are you doing? But right. I would just say, you know, you come to faith and then God does work in you. And like our own children, you know, we don't really want to listen all the time. I often say, you know, man wants to rebel against God, his wife against him, the kids against them. Mm. So when you understand that picture from Genesis that I'm sure we'll unpack in a bit, talking about pride and humility, if you stay focused on Jesus, he exposes things to help you grow, to keep you humble. Mm. And that's really where the strength comes from. Because then you and I get up today like today and say, Lord, here's a church service. We're brothers in Christ. We're humbly doing whatever you need us to do. And back to your point, there should be a boldness in that. Jesus came boldly. There was an agenda. There was a mission. I love that statement that we're invincible until God takes us. That means every one of us today, especially in 2020, amid, you know, crazy election season and COVID and all the rest, we should have confidence and boldness. You're there on the East Coast. Here I am on the West Coast. We're Ephesians 2:10. We're God's workmanship. In the same way this phone was to be used to make calls or this cup be used to drink water out of, you and I were made to be used by God today. And when this goes live, as people live it out, there's my boldness. I'm his vessel. We're the dirt, the spirit, the ruach's been breathed into us. That should bring us to a place of humility with confidence, back to the Beatitudes, meekness. So
yeah, no, that's good. You know, you prior to, you know, your coming to Jesus, right? That revelation, and really, I mean, it was an experience because you've shared it. And if you haven't seen Brian's video of his, you know, encounter that he had with Jesus on the floor in the room that you're, you know, in the house that you're sitting in right now, you know, check that out on YouTube. But keeping that in mind, you know, we have this conversion that we're at some place in our life and we've come to Jesus. You know, people use it as a punchline, right? Oh, the, you know, coming to Jesus moment. But when you actually have that transformation happen, when you have everything that you thought life was, everything that you thought life was built for and direction you were headed, and all of a sudden, boom, you make this decision and something changes and he actually changes you from the inside out. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't, for some people, it's a major thing that happens all at once. But for the majority of us, we have to walk that out. Mm. There's humility in that, what I've recognized, and yourself. I mean, you, prior to that, you're traveling around the world. You're skating for Tony Hawk and Birdhouse and seeing all of this, you know, major, you know, names on skateboards and video games and all this stuff. And all of a sudden now you're coming in that same circle of people. Mm. And are they looking at you saying, hey, what happened to Brian? Like,
I think they're probably still looking at me thinking that this goes up on my, like, what is this guy doing?
Yeah.
But, you know, I guess I'd say this for those who are just tuning in, you know, hi church. Thanks for having me on. I know you've got a bunch of new listeners as well.
Yeah.
But I was a skateboarder from 13 years of age on. That's all I did. And getting sponsored by Tony Hawk and all these companies, it wasn't huge then, but it began to grow. So in our little bubble of life, I became one of those very known skateboarders, made it to America, had a good 15, 20 year run career, you could say, making really good money, traveling the world. I think what kept me humble in those situations, though, was that not being a citizen yet, knowing at any moment you could break your ankle and not have a career. Mm. It almost was like I came to America and I had to always be cautious and aware and realize that I don't know if I'm going to become a citizen. I don't know what I'm going to do. This is all before coming to faith. So then when I come to faith, you know, our story in a nutshell was being married without Christ, having Dakota, fighting, getting depressed, getting divorced, you know, pretty much suicidal. coming to faith, hey, coming to faith, our marriage restored. Most of the church knows this. I've been out there doing, you know, the marriage conferences and the book never fails and the rest. But right then, it was almost like a 21, 22, 23. Your whole life's different. I'm not just only thinking about skating now. I've traveled and had the pro shoe and been in the magazines and all the rest, seen a lot of what the world offers, realized early that it isn't everything because, you know, here's the funny thing is when you go as a skater, all these very famous actors and whoever it is in Hollywood and people you're around because of that world, all their kids think you're cool. They don't care about their parents. And you see these people with, you know, who knows how much money living this whole life. And it's no different than where you are. Skating was everything. But now coming to faith, I'm like, Lord, I need help in my marriage. I need to know what you've called me to do. So I went into faith saying, my life got so crazy for the 2 or 3 years you went through that whole fight and divorce thing. I got humbled in that. So then coming to faith, and to put it straight, you know, I'd say this, I almost felt like John the Baptist. I came to faith, you know, at 24 in the room right here where my two kids are still sleeping. Maybe they're up listening to this. But, you know, right away, I'm like, okay, I've been a skateboarder for many years. This is all I do, 6 or 7 hours a day. If I'm now a Christian, if God's filled me, if the Holy Spirit's in me, what am I called to do? And sadly, a lot of times Christians don't think that way because they've just been raised in the church. Like, are my kids waking up going, what do we do today? They're just like, oh, we're Christians. This is life. Even for Dakota, you know, my 20-year-old who's going to get married in April, you know, and he's awesome young kid, very proud of him, works hard, diligent, went through his few little years of being the older kid who challenges you. And praise God for that. You know, it was easy. But I'm saying, you know, just for those listening, saying we're all living in the real world here.
Yeah, right.
But to the point, now living this out, it's like, okay, Lord, they're not sitting here thinking, what do we do for Jesus? They're just Christian. Or for me, it was like, okay, I am living in America. I am riding for these companies. I need to know in God's word, what do I do? And so immediately you're seeing Jesus say, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. You're seeing him show them for 3.5 years. You're seeing him talk about humility. So I had to apply that to my life, go through the anger management, do all the marriage stuff with my wife. We got married and the skate whale just looked at me like, what is this guy doing? Yeah. Quit a lot of these big sponsors. But I'll tell you, I was in church praying in a pew at the old church I was. And I said, Lord, what do you want me to do with skating? And I didn't hear an audible voice, but I felt impressed. I know it's subjective to everyone. Yeah. I feel like the Lord impressed on me, take off your shoes. You know, this is holy ground. And I said, well, Lord, the verse is take off your sandals. And it was like God was saying, no, what I'm saying is skating is in the main focus. And the impression I got, and I say this to people who understand this, whatever you want to say, I just felt like God downloaded into me. Every 5 years, people are going to check in with you, the skate culture, and they're going to see you're married. They're going to see you're pastoring. They're going to see you do a ministry. And that's going to be the witness. So yeah. For me coming out to hang out with you guys, for me doing this, you know, this is now what, 15 years later. And the amount of skaters that check in on what I'm doing, I went and witnessed to them all. I went and shared with all the pros. They all know Brian's is Christian, blah, blah, blah. But when I go to the skate park, like last night, and all these kids are getting stoned and hammered and whatever, and they see Brian Sumner, this old school skater, and I go hang out with them, they see this guy's a pastor and he loves skating and he loves us. So it's like the Lord is going to use that still. That allowed me to say, God, I want to focus on what you have. And frankly, Paul, if I wasn't doing this, if I wasn't as deep in ministry right away, I'm so compulsive. I could have fell back in a, I mean, not by, you know, by the grace of God, no. But that humility, not me, but knowing I'm so dependent on the Lord is what's helped me say, no, Bible first, you know, church first, Christianity first. So that in itself is a massive lesson.
Like, I guess it's the same way that when you see a railing that you want to skate and you just do it all day long, every day, back there every day.
Well, you know, one thing.
I will conquer that. Determination, you know. So yeah, God wired you that way, really, is what you're saying. You've been wired that way. Now he's using you the way that he wired you.
Well, how many women are sitting there and they're literally say of their husband, you're so compulsive, you're so OCD. Did God make you that way? Is that just the way you hit the nail? I'm an evangelist. I don't say that with like, I'm an evangelist. That's how I speak. I sound like everything's bent towards an altar call or someone coming to faith or the conversation today being the day of salvation. So
Yeah.
You got to land your rhythm and land your gifting as well. So.
Yeah. No, that's great. And, you know, you could look at what you've done just in ministry, how God's taking that platform of skating and now transition that into ministry. Mm-hmm. And obviously the testimony of just not just using that platform, but using it for how many years did you say?
Well, 2004, you know, and it's 2020. So, yeah. You know, immediately you come into faith and you're around guys like Stephen Ball and Brian Welch, you know, the Luis Palau Festival, Franklin Graham's ministry. They're all seeing you as this pro skater. So you're thrown in on these platforms and you're speaking. And I'm like, this isn't what I planned. I could go start a skate, you know, business or something. I'm going to get on a stage and speak. That's a humbling thing. I don't know if you guys want to give, you know, speeches in your workplace at the end of every week, but that's pretty much what ministry is like. Yeah. You go to Costa Rica for 5 days and preach 9 times. You get humbled. So it kind of woke me up quick. Like, okay, Lord, if this is you, help me. Because I'm not a preacher. But then obviously God has opened that office for me. So, okay, Lord, I'll go share.
Yeah. Well, the Bible says he'll exalt the humble, right? So that's it. Right? I've even seen you've spoken at Liberty University with, I don't know how many thousands of people there. And it wasn't that long ago I sent you a message. I said, hey, dude, you're on TBS or something. Was it 19 and counting or something like that?
They always have this, the 700 Club, all those things, even like the Washington Monument. I am second as a video thing set up and it plays all these testimonies. And we had a testimony on that. So I'll get people who were like from Liverpool where I grew up, Brian, I'm in Washington and your story's on this. So to them, it is huge. I mean, God is just, but why wouldn't God do that? They say skating and music are some of the most influential things in the world. Definitely America right now. The top two things is music and skateboarding. So if God's going to use skaters, why wouldn't he do this right now? If I rode for Tony Hawk, if I have this powerful testimony, because it's the gospel, it's the power and the salvation.
I guess skateboarding, cranberry juice, and Fleetwood Mac, I guess, would be the thing that's all coming.
Yeah, there it is.
The longboard.
Yeah.
We could see how God takes where we were, what we've been doing. For me, business, so he's like, okay, you kind of know a little bit about business. You know a little bit about this. You can kind of manage things. I want you to start a church. And I'm saying, what? No. You know, but eventually, you know, you submit, you get spit out of the fish on the beach, and and now you're okay. That's where I'm headed, I guess. You know, when you look at the humility in the Bible, when we read through the Bible. Who do you connect with? I should say, in the Bible, as a character, it says, you know what? This really hits me right to the core of humility when I think of people in the Bible.
Well, you know, I like to put things in categories, I guess, compartmentalized. So if you look at the whole Bible, if I say, what's the biggest sin? What's the biggest struggle? Yes, I get blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, where a person doesn't receive Jesus, resists, you know, salvation, whatever way God works it out. But if you look at the heart of the issue, the whole issue, it's pride. I mean, Genesis is where it all begins. Proverbs 16:18 says, pride goes before the fall. So right there, let's just set up Genesis. You have God, Elohim, who's created. You have the serpent. You have Adam made. Then Eve comes out from Adam's side, you know, out of his rib, his cell structure in the Hebrew. God puts them in the garden. He's already told the serpent. The serpent already knows who God is. Everyone's meant to worship him. In serpent's pride, he's rebelled against God. You know, what is it, Isaiah, how it's the five I wills. I'm into the mountain of God. I'm going to be like God. There's pride in the serpent not listening to God. Then you have Adam and Eve. Guys, enjoy this whole lush land. I mean, everything you eat tastes great. All the things the animals do around you, no one's trying to kill you. There's been no death. You've got a beautiful wife. I mean, here's what's going on. But the only thing God says is just don't eat of that tree. And so what did they do? They listened to God, or in the pride. Yes, there was deception, but they chose another path. They chose another sin. And even when you read Genesis, if I said to the congregation today, you know, what did they eat? Look at the text. It doesn't tell us what they eat. They ate of the fruit. We don't know what that was. And even just thinking about this, when you look at Genesis, listen to this for Genesis 3:6. It says, when the woman saw, when she looked, there it was. It was in front of her. When she saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, that's one thing. It was pleasing to the eye, a second thing. And it was desirable for gaining wisdom. She ate. When she saw three things right there, we see it. It's good for food. It's pleasing to the eye, desirable for gaining wisdom. Then she ate. Whatever happened, there was three things that were there. These three things are what stir us up away from God. And you say, well, Brian, what are you talking about? There's three things in the garden. There's three things Jesus overcame in Matthew 4 when Satan came and tempted him with the same three things. And even in John, we read in 1 John 2:16, this is to the Christian, all that is in the world, and you know this, Pastor Paul, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's the same three things. So to start for the congregation, pride comes out of, it's going to make me feel good. It's going to be something outside of God today's, you know, my own way or this new ageism or whatever way you want to talk about it. It's these three things. So they're the opportunity in the garden to be humble and meek and trust in God. And they didn't. They ate of the fruit. That's why we're in this place today. So when you say, who's the example, though, I want your congregation to know, guys, the Bible's the story of chaos. It's God's plan, which is perfect, but you are seeing man be crazy and reckless. So if you're sitting there on the couch or you're listening to this on the drive or whatever, we are train wrecks without the Holy Spirit, without the blood of Jesus. And to answer your question about Moses, I kind of wanted to set that up kind of like a sermon.
Sure.
To me, I look at examples like Moses. Moses was a guy who in his 40s tried to do what he thought God wanted him to do, gets in a fight, you know, kills an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew slave. If Moses would have been elevated then and done things his way, he would have led the whole nation of Israel to destruction. That was his pride. So God had to work on him, puts him out in the wilderness for 40 years. Moses is walking around shepherding sheep, thinks his people have forgotten him, thinks God has forgotten him. God hasn't. God has a plan for all of us. I don't mean everything they're saying on the television, that you've got to be this or be that. I mean God has a better plan than anyone can tell you. And what I mean by that is, like I said earlier, Ephesians 2, where is workmanship? God would then go to Moses, take Moses. Moses didn't want to go. He couldn't speak. He didn't know what was going on. You're sending me to Pharaoh, someone I'd known in my prior years. I mean, Moses is an Egyptian name. God sends him. Aaron comes along, and you see Moses in his meekness, even though he's struggling, he's bold for the things of God. He knows where he's powerful in the things of the Lord. He moves. So to me, I see Moses as a guy who just trusted what God brought to him. He trusted daily. Who do I love in the Bible you're talking about? I love Daniel. Daniel is someone we never hear of him sinning, but we know he did because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Daniel's parents knew there was a prophecy from Jeremiah, 70-year exile. Paul, we're coming to Massachusetts. We're taking you out for 70 years. You still go ahead and have your kids. That's what the nation of Israel did. Here's Daniel. Daniel lived through three kings. He's someone who purposed in his heart, which means I'm going to choose the Lord's way. And he lived this life of meekness, but boldness. And of course, I have to say with this, you know, these are all representations of Christ as well.
Yeah.
But Joseph was a young man, the youngest of the father's sons, who God gave the vision and dream, wouldn't come to pass for 13 years. His brothers hated him, beat him, threw him in a pit, sold him into slavery. And he's accused, he's thrown in prison. But Joseph was focused on the Lord, and God used him through his boldness and his meekness. And I'd say, of course, we have to say Jesus. I mean, think about this. We don't talk about this a lot, but for 30 years, Jesus was walking around and he's God. And you know, kids are making fun of him. People are smacking him on the head, pushed him down the hill once in a while. I don't know what they could have done to him, but he was a man just like you and us in the flesh, but he was God. He lived for 30 years among some wretched people, all of us. That's humility. And then he goes in the Jordan. John shouts, behold, the Lamb of God, filled with the Spirit of God, anointed, goes into the temple there, or in the synagogue in Luke 4, and begins to announce his ministry. And he humbly but boldly goes about for 3.5 years, signs, miracles, wonders, love, being hated, being challenged. Mm. And here's the amazing thing. He looked at you, Paul. He looked at me. He looked at your church. He looked at those who might be listening or watching. And he picked us to go and humbly follow him. I mean, what else do you want to do with your life? You know, make millions. You want to go chase women. You want to go be the top of this. You know, you're chasing Babylon still. Get there to the top. What are we doing? What kingdom are we building? So right. I see Moses as someone who tried to do it his way, and God says, I've got something better for you. I see Daniel. I see Joseph. And, of course, we see Jesus. And so there's just – I'm saying this to say throughout the Bible are pictures of humility. Every time you see people blowing it, it's pride. They wanted a king they could see. Here's Saul. He's handsome. He's tall. We all want something. Show me the check. Show me where the ministry is going to be. Show me the size of the vineyard. I'm Paul, the businessman, me and Karen. We're not going to be able to plant a church. God's like, guys, please. I remember those conversations, you know, the Lord's calling me to do this, to do this. He'll only let you know enough because tomorrow has to have its own faith. So even as a speaker, even as a pastor, we have to depend on God every day. So all these people are great examples. Even David, who I don't want to be like David, who was a man after God's own heart as far as he loved the Lord. Sure. The difference with David and Saul was Saul never really repented. When he got called out, he blamed everyone else. Mm. But David knew and repented. That's it.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, one of the things I tell my kids the most is if all you ever learn from me is that, man, I am nothing without Christ, then I've done my job. You know what I mean?
So, right. Yeah. I mean, that's really, I think, you know, we're kind of the saying that throughout the vineyard, you know, change in his pocket, right? Mm-hmm. Let him spend us the way he wants to spend us.
Amen. Yeah. I never heard that before. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and I don't know who said it, so I can't really quote them, but it wasn't me. So I didn't make that. I got to be humble in that and not take credit for it, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, thinking about being in ministry, being in leadership, being a husband, being a father, you know, you're leading in some capacity, right? I'm not talking, you know, old school dominating, you know, you're the man of the house, this is my king type of stuff. I'm talking in general, we're meant to be leading. Like God created us to lead. When that leadership gets challenged, you know, and this is me guy to guy with you and the other guys that are listening, when that leadership gets challenged, that is a huge opportunity for humility, for us to actually look into ourselves and say, is there any pride rising in this? Is there anything that's coming up in here that's not of God?
And are we going to put this out for people to hear? I'm just kidding, church. I'm joking. And that was the point. Right. Listen, I get into it with my kids yesterday. I mean, all the time. I'll tell you, like I said earlier, yes, I love the Lord. I have a load of notes. I have Bibles. I love Christians. But daily, do I want to do everything God says? Think about even for my wife who loves me, loves her family. Genesis says she'll be under a curse where she'll seek to want to rule me. You want to go right? You know what? She wants to go left. And that's wanting to do it God's way. You guys have to remember we're living in this cursed world where Paul and I are aging right now. People are passing right now. My kids are going to wake up and maybe my son's in there going, oh, dad's doing another thing on the phone. I can't go outside right now. And maybe June, they're going to go, I want to skate here. So what you said is amazing because every interaction is an opportunity for humility. Guys, we homeschool. My wife runs her pretty much raw foods business right here out of the kitchen. We are always in front of each other. It's easy to reach out at each other's throat to say things you don't mean. That is hard. It's always easy to play the pastor card. Well, you're the pastor and you're this and you're that. Well, you're the pastor's wife and you're the pastor's kids. But I'll tell you, you have to look at every interaction. And guys, where you've failed, where you've said things, there isn't a time when I go on a trip and while I'm on a trip, I'm like, wow, I wish I'd have said this better. I wish I could have been like this. And you've got to know part of that is that we're all just living in this. It's not an excuse. We don't want to lower the bar.
Sure.
You're the people who are like, well, everyone struggles with, you know, watching this online. So we're all going to do it. I mean, watching adult things or shouting at each other. We want to higher the bar again and go, no, we have the Holy Spirit. Every time this conflict is an opportunity to say less of me, more of him. I must decrease, he can increase. And Romans 8:14, as many as are led by the Spirit of God. There's not fruits of the Spirit. It's a fruit. It's shown in many ways, but I have an opportunity. Lord, this family's driving me crazy today, or my wife said this, or my kids said that, or I want to say this. It's hard. It's hard to always have track of your flesh. But God is present there. Some of you watching in your marriage, the reason it's not going the way you guys both want is you're not submitted to the Lord. Mm-hmm. You want your spouse to be submitted to you. You're still king in the home or queen in the home. That's not God's way. You running a church, if you were going a certain way, I go, Paul, you're not the main guy. Jesus is. I never have to say, get out the way. But people watching, they're going to come in and go, I don't want to hear this worship song. Oh, this person's preaching. Guys, it's all pride in some way. And I love the idea that, you know, in America right now, it'd be really easy to go find 50 people, build a mega church. There's the best guitarist. There's the best speaker. There's the most influential. God doesn't do that. God builds a team and he goes, the goalkeeper's hobbling. But you know what? I like his heart. I'm going to use him because when you get beat, he's in it for the game. I'm going to use the striker. I'm using the idea of how God puts teams together.
Yeah.
You come into your family, you come into your church, you come into your life. And even for Jesus, he came not to be served, but to serve. If you have that mindset, which is hard, we're the fast food generation. I'm already thinking about where I'm going to go eat prior to this. I'm thinking about where I'm going to take Jude skating. I'm thinking about my day. And I have to be reminded, Lord, just like you said, Vineyard, whoever said that, change in your pocket. Lord, yeah. What do you want? Where do you want to spend us today? That's the adventure. I sat with a guy recently who'd been unfaithful to his wife, who was justifying all the reasons why. And he loves the Lord. He was raised in the faith and it suddenly happened. He's like, man, I just want to live this adventure and have this and have that. And I was sitting there like, Lord, what do I say? And I said, you don't think loving your wife, being willing to have kids that she wants because he didn't. He was like, I just want to go live this big adventure and travel. And I said, you don't think loving her through the thick and thin, having kids through the thick and thin is the best adventure as you honor Jesus? Yeah. And he got it. Yeah. I didn't think it sounded that good, but it was like the Lord used that. You know what I mean? So I'm saying the humble road is going to be the road where you see the Lord move most, especially in a church like the Vineyard where we're saying, Holy Spirit, move. He doesn't need to move a lot if we're not trying to do anything. He's already the one moving. Right. We're not waiting on him. He's waiting on us. He already arrived 2,000 years ago. So into his rhythms. They need to be humble. And when you're prideful, God's your father. He loves you. Just give it over to him. Don't beat yourself up either. That's what the devil wants to do.
Yeah, that's good. Well, I just want to, looking at the clock here. So, I mean, you and I could go talk about this all day long, but I just want to give you a minute before we close in prayer. If you want to just share while we've got this video up, you know, where are you at with your ministry? What's coming up for you? You're in the middle of COVID, you know, with like the rest of us. So obviously traveling and doing big events and things like that, that's just not happening right now.
One of the things that we've always been able to minister through, and it's funny because Pastor Paul, when we even first met and did an event, you're such a business mind and the structure, like, hey, you're going to come out and do this event. What do we do? And people say, how do you plan what you do? And I say, I'm just ready in and out of season. I don't know what I'm doing the next week. Normally, when there's not COVID, you have things planned out. You can do it. But I remember showing up to the event and you want everything structured, which is the what you need to do. And I'm like, hey, there's skaters. We'll figure it out when we get there. And you had no idea what I meant. And we get to the skate park.
Freaking out. Like, we got like 100 people showing up. What are we doing?
You got pizza showing up and ice cream. And so literally, you know, and I'm saying an ice cream that you eat. There's all these skaters and you're like, what do we do? And I said, okay, give me the mic. Hey, you guys, because I know we're going to a skate park that's a Christian event. They don't really want you there. Here comes the church. Don't we care about money and really sketchy things happening with kids, you know, in certain congregations years ago and all this stuff. And so, no. I go, guys, where do you want to skate? They used to come over. We want to skate this obstacle. We want to do these tricks. It's their park. And you said, okay, I get it. That's kind of how I approach ministry, where it was a lot of travel and doing whatever, you know, missions, marriages, ministry. Mm-hmm. And for those watching, guys, you, those of you pray and partner, thank you, Vineyard, that your church personally supports me financially so I can do what I do every month. And there's a couple, handful of churches of friends who partner with me. There's people who are Christians that partner with me. And 1 Corinthians 9:14 says, God commands those who do the work of the gospel, make their living from it. I'm meant to make my living by just being ready. Brian, fly out and do a whole thing with us. Okay. Yeah. So that's been the model, Lord, whatever you want. What's been amazing is since COVID hit, I mean, guys, this is sad. I'm imagining November 4th, the day after. I think people are going to be losing their minds in this country. There's already been so much depression, so much suicide, so many people, like, whether it's COVID or election stuff, freaking out. What that's done for me is allowed the ministry to be very focused on people. A lot of marriage ministry, a lot of sitting with younger adults, a lot of ministry around the world. And I got invited onto a church in the Philippines. In the Philippines, everything shut down. They put a little thing, a guy who's like 16, professional skateboarder and pastor, Brian, doing a Zoom call. I go on the Zoom call, there's hundreds of people. There's like grandmas sitting in their kitchen, all these people's names, and I'm trying to pronounce them, and they're all laughing. It's funny. But I'm like, Lord, if this was when COVID wasn't going on, they'd all be out. But because they're locked down two times a week, they get to go out. I got like 2 hours with them. And so God has been doing that, a lot of weddings actually, and just, man, a lot of the podcast and a lot of local ministry. So, you know, I'll tell you, when you say, how do you operate humbly? Not that I'm saying that. I got my own struggles and issues. We're always going to grow. The Apostle Paul, you, me, all of us, aside from Jesus. But I just go, Lord, we don't know what's next. Some people are so focused on the end times. Hey, we should watch, but there's work to be done. Jesus said, occupy till I come, and don't be anxious. Lay aside the weight, be filled with the Spirit, be planted in your home church, wherever you may be, you know, open up the Word of God. And even just looking at, you know, some of the thoughts you think about 1 Peter 5:5, that God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. That verse implies that God opposes your prideful choices. You can't really walk in the streams of the Holy Spirit when you're being prideful, if it's in your marriage, if it's in your parenting, if it's in your career. But He gives grace and life and His Spirit to what? The humble. We have the Holy Spirit, but we can be operating out of pride. And what a time to be alive, where some people are more focused on America than God's kingdom, and more focused on our fear than faith. So for me, with ministry, Lord, whatever you have, bring it to me. You want to do this video today? I'm here with Pastor Paul. We're hanging out with brothers. I hope it's encouraging the congregation that God loves you. He sent His Son for you. You are to die for, but that there's an amazing work to be done, that in our humility and meekness, we're going to see souls come into the kingdom. So,
amen. Yeah. Yeah, it's good stuff. Well, I mean, it's just awesome. It's great to see. And thanks for coming on this morning.
Of course.
And sharing. You know, you're an encouragement to all of us out here, and we are just happy to partner with you.
Thank Brian's you so ministry, much.
You know, if anybody wants to check it out, it's briansumner.net, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so check that out. If your heart's being pulled on that to maybe partner with them, certainly do so. Brian, you want to just pray us out here?
And let me lead into it with just really, because you started with the Beatitudes.
Yeah.
And we talked about this prior. But when we read the Beatitudes, as Pastor Paul has said, Jesus is speaking to the disciples. So when He gives a list of all these things, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, He's not just saying any person on a hillside who's poor, blessed are they. He's literally speaking to religious leaders in that region who had taken control, who used God's law and commands religiously. It'd become a system of religion. And now Israel and those people didn't really have a shepherd. And Jesus is showing up, about to send the disciples out, about to send you and I out. And He says, when you live this way, because you've been forgiven by me, because you have the Holy Spirit, when you're humble, when you're meek, when you're all these things He lists there in Matthew 5, the kingdom will be yours. And here's why this is crazy. Jesus says things like, you have heard it said, but I say unto you. That's like 2,000 years ago. Sorry, Paul, but I'll use the example. Paul's the wretched Pharisee who's bullying you all. And I'm saying, you've heard Paul say, but here's what I'm saying. And this is why Jesus says, do what they say, not what they do. They misunderstood the law. They talked about it, but they didn't get it. What do I mean? Here's the big picture, then I'll pray. We look at the Old Testament as the Ten Commandments were given just to convict us. Yes, they do that. They show us we're sinners. We see Israel had 613, and even later they have thousands and thousands. The goal isn't to keep them like a video game, so we go, I did that. No one can do that. The goal of them was to love God, the first four commandments, and the goal of them was to love your neighbor and be able to judge yourself. That was the next six. The first four are to God, the next six are to one another. So when Jesus, the rabbi, comes by and they say, what's the greatest commandment? That's an invitation for him to tell you, here's Paul, he's coming through Huntington Beach. Hey, Rabbi, what's the greatest commandment? What I'm saying is I want to hear your teaching. And every rabbi said the same thing. Love the Lord your God with heart, soul, mind. That's always the first. But sometimes they would say, keep the Sabbath. Sometimes they would say, honor their parents. They all had variations, but Jesus gives us the real teaching of it all. I didn't come to do away with it, but to fulfill it. He meant, this is it. And this is in the Pastor Paul's message, the humility and meekness. He said, love your neighbor as yourself. The whole of the Old Testament is love God and your neighbor. Go out and invite all the nations in. And they did. The only reason people were killed and slain and torn apart is they were terrorists opposing Israel against them for centuries. So God had to take people out because he had to bring the Messiah. You get to 2,000 years ago, and here's the message. The kingdom is going forth. It's a loving message of humility and boldness. Vineyard Church, whatever ups and downs you might have, humility and boldness. Our church, whatever people are struggling with, humility and boldness. That is the message of Jesus. You've heard it said, but I say unto you, and it even says in this verse that they were amazed by his teaching. Sadly, they missed it because it was religion, but he was saying it's about God and people. Mm. Let's pray, you guys.
Yeah, absolutely.
Lord, I just thank you, God, for Paul, for Karen, for that whole team, God, for the pastors that are there, the ministry, and humility, Lord. We see the lights and the bells and whistles of American culture. We feel like you're really moving if it's bigger and better than everywhere else, but God, that's not how you moved. You moved through a carpenter, a shepherd, a young boy that was there 2,000 years ago through Jesus, who's alive and resurrected today. And God, you used him in a mighty way, and that ministry is still going. I pray over that church, over those people, God, over their marriages, over their lives, over their resources. God, use them all with humility. I don't know what someone's struggling with, God, but we pray against that today. Give them the strength and humility to trust you. To say, where is pride in my marriage? Where is pride in my finances? Where is pride in my vision? That their business will be yours, that their life will be yours, that their family will be yours, that, Lord, everything they touch, whatever is in your hand, give as unto the Lord. And God, I pray for abundance of wisdom. As America is looking as crazy as it's ever looked, your kingdom is still the same, and not one letter of your word will pass away. God, I pray for favor on the anointing of the teaching, the preaching in the council, and for just broken homes to be fixed. God, establish your name in that community. I thank you for Paul, for Karen, for the team, the amazing people out there. God, we pray for our nation, and that those who are broken and shattered would come to know you, because you are who gives life and life more abundantly. God, you are faithful, you are good, and we lift up your name, Jesus, that those who don't know you, who today the Holy Spirit's convicting of sin, would come to know you. You can be forgiven freely as a child as you repent and say, God, I need that. I need the encounter with you. I need to be forgiven and enter eternal life. God, we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brian. Hey, everyone, tune in next week. We'll be moving on in the Beatitudes. And thanks again for tuning in. God bless. Have a great week.